Nighttime on Still Waters. This is NB506812, narrowcasting into the night from somewhere on Britain's waterways. November 5th, Friday. A chill greyness has seeped into the landscape that all the silver dawns and sunsets of fiery bronze cannot shift. COP26 started this week, and Twitter and news feeds are not good places to be. So I stand by the big oak, listening for the raven's call and the windsong of geese. Above me, chemtrails flower on a cobalt sky, and at my feet, a clover leaf laced with ice. Welcome. It's lovely to see you. How are you? I hope you're well. After a scattered residue of fireworks that nuzzled the clouds with their brittle lights, the quietness of night is returning again. Although you might still catch a faint, sharp, gunpowdery tang on the wind, or the hint of wood smoke, sweet on the air. So welcome aboard on this classic November night. This is the narrowboat 506812 Erica, narrowcasting to you on the gentle waters of a moonless night. I'm so grateful that you've taken the time to come. All day a westerly wind has been raking the trees and the hedgerows, and the reeds like pennant flags, signalling messages for eyes more perceptive than mine. The alder and the ash are losing their leaves now, streaming out on the gusts of wind, or lazily spiralling and helicoptering to the towpath and fields in the yellow and ochres of autumn. And immediately I'm taken back to my childhood and school days, and that small figure of David Southam happily and in a world of his own catching leaves as they blew in from the wood that bordered the playground. And I remember that for a while I once joined him. It was like chasing airborne fish that slipped through your fingers as quick as anything. And then, after a while, something must have captured my interest and I went off. And from time to time I would look across at that neat, trim little figure in his grey school V-neck jumper and shorts and his school tie always neatly tied, contented, on his own amidst a blizzard of golden leaves. And falling leaves always remind me of David Southam on a small junior school playground beside a wood that is turning the world into a golden snow globe. An almost continuous flotilla of fallen ash leaves float slowly past us. They remind me so much of Egyptian barks gliding down the Nile. And it gives that rather weird and disorienting impression that we are moving. Last weekend the clocks went back, and in the span of one night, darkness began to lap at the edges of our late afternoons. And the encroachment of night leading the tide of winter into our daytimes can now no longer be ignored. And alongside this, a northerly wind flow has dragged down some colder air. It's not been desperately cold, but enough to remind us of the realities of locks frozen tight, the stinging nip of frosty air in the nose, and the chill of paddling through muddy fields. There's not really been much news about the situation with the bird flu, only that it's now been officially declared, and the local news is not good. 20 swans have died in Stratford-upon-Avon, just a few miles down the canal from us. But our trio of swans still keep visiting. And another pair flew overhead on Friday. They seemed interested, but fortunately the presence of our three seemed enough to dissuade them from further exploration. Tension and possible conflict averted. The juvenile moorhens are now pretty much fully grown, and the coot is once more a regular visitor. The ducks are clustering more and gathering round the boats in a circuit of foraging. Friday night was Guy Fawkes night, and there was a display not far from here, but fortunately Penny couldn't hear it, and although she was aware of it, she wasn't distressed by it. Her deteriorating hearing does have some advantages. Last week's episode on Halloween and my memories about Swedehead lanterns seems to have struck quite a chord. Thank you to everyone who commented or who contacted me. Thank you to Mike Stowe and Vanessa and Steve Tyrrell on that beautiful narrowboat Precious Jet for your memories and your kind words. And hello and thank you also to Claire Marsden. I really appreciate that retweet and your lovely words. Thank you so much. And over on Facebook, hello and thank you to Sarah Wally. Yes, Swedeheads do have a very distinctive smell. And Nancy Jean Armstrong, and Wayne and Amanda and Bella, of course, from the NBA Kern. Or Carol Knight Ennis and Jan Crow, who's just actually down the couple of boats down from us. And Jean Mann. And over on Instagram, it was really lovely to reconnect with someone from the old blogger days. Angela from the Faraway Tree. Thank you so much for getting back in contact. It was lovely to meet up with you again. And the episode on fungi also still seems to be attracting some comments. Arlene Kettering from over in Seattle sent some photographs of a mushroom foraging trip that she's just completed, where she harvested 8 pounds of chanterelle mushrooms, as well as lots of other types. And Olivia Marty, again over in the States, am I dreaming it, or did you also show me some photographs of a huge haul of mushrooms that you had foraged? Clearly, the place for mushrooming is the United States. You seem to have huge amounts there. It was also lovely to hear from you, Tracy, who contacted me on the nighttimeonstillwaters@gmail.com. And reminisce of the old radio programs that we used to listen to. The episode on the shipping forecast prompted it, and Tracy works with people with dementia and was using the radio as reminiscence therapy. And that brought up all sorts of names from the past. Jimmy Young and Raimondo and What's the Recipe Today, Jim? And Pete Murray and Diddy David Hamilton. And apparently Tracy got a request played on the Diddy David Hamilton's afternoon radio show to celebrate getting her O-levels. So thank you all so much for getting in contact, and please keep doing that. It's really lovely to hear from you. And contact details are in the program notes below. And also, fellow podcasters keep telling me that I really need to be pushing the please subscribe or click like or leave a review. So if you do have the opportunity to just click like on your podcast platform or whatever it is that you're listening to it on. I know it's not always there, and I hate keeping on saying this. It makes me cringe, but apparently it really does make a difference. And if you can leave a review, that's even better, but no pressure. The cooler weather, together with the night steadily drawing in, has meant that the stove is being used in earnest rather than just as a cozy accessory. And it begins to take more of our attention and become more central in our day-to-day living. We tend it a little more carefully, riddling the ash, adjusting the air vents to optimize the amount of airflow and burn rate. And each night it's banked up and damped down with more judicious care. If it goes out, it's not the end of the world, but it's good if it doesn't. And it's not simply for heat, though that, of course, is primary. But it's also about warmth, the glow. At different times, cherry, scarlet, crimson, ruby, carmine, strawberry and orange. And each shade a song of warmth that fills the boat and the spirit with something richer than just radiated heat. It's companionable. And I think that it would be difficult to feel really alone in the presence of a real fire. Listen to the British-Canadian poet Robert Service, the Bard of the Yukon. He's been described as the poet laureate of the pioneering wilderness of the Canadian West and the Gold Rush. And he writes with a swaggering meter that boils with such a bold, if ultimately misguided and flawed, courage. His ballad of One-Eyed Mike begins, "This is the tale that was told to me by the man with the crystal eye. As I smoked my pipe in the campfire light and the glories swept the sky. As the north lights gleamed and curved and steamed and the bottle of hooch was dry." This is man, and it is almost exclusively men, pitted against nature in lethal combat. This is the ethic of dominion writ large with all its machismo and new world sense of pioneering masculinity. And while women do feature, and they are as often as robust and as uncompromising as the landscape, but essentially like gold and the land, they too are prizes to be won and to ultimately possess. And Service's protagonists are almost universally loners, outcasts, mavericks, skating on the thin ice at the edges of society. And the open fire under the Klondike's night skies with its stars as hard as flint shards, or the glowing stove in a backwoods cabin, feature as a powerfully recurring motif. In his The Lure of Little Voices, which is his attempt to express that drive for the open spaces, the wilderness, that is sometimes so complicated and conflicted, he writes, "They miss my little campfires, ever brightly, bravely gleaming in the womb of desolation where was never man before." And this is classic Service, and a device that he uses so often, but each time the scene and its poignancy is captured so perfectly, that sense of isolation, being outcast under brittle skies, lost and alone in a great wilderness. His poem, The Logger, begins, "In the moonless misty night, with my little pipe alight, I am sitting by the campfire's fading cheer. Oh, the dew is falling chill on the dim, dear, haunted hill, and the breakers in the bay are moaning drear. The toilful hours are sped, the boys are long abed, and I alone a weary vigil keep. In the sightless sullen sky I can hear the nighthawk cry, and the frogs in frenzied chorus from the creek. And somehow the ember's glow brings me back the long ago, the days of merry laughter and light song. For these desperately isolated and often broken figures, the campfire or the cabin stove provide the human warmth and sense of companionship and relative safety that they otherwise lack. And I suppose we shouldn't be too surprised. Service, having lived in the Yukon, well knew that harsh and unforgiving terrain, meteorologically as well as geographically, psychologically as well as physiologically. Fire is what kept a person alive. And so the campfire and the stove become almost characters in themselves. And in many ways, the only ally to the characters who populate his verse. In fact, he even devotes an entire poem to it. The song of the campfire begins, "Heed me, feed me, I am hungry, red-tongued with desire. Boughs of balsam, slabs of cedar, gummy faggots of the pine. Heap them on me, let me hug them to my eager heart of fire. Roaring, soaring up to heaven as a symbol and a sign, bring me knots of sunny maple, silver birch and tamarack. Leaping, sweeping, I will lap them with my ardent wings of flame. I will kindle them to glory. I will beat the darkness back." The poem then charts the fire's life until its inevitable death, finishing with that small heap of glowing ashes. "A little heap of ashes, yea, miracle divine, the footprint of a god, or radiant fire." And there is a sense that this Promethean gift is a living creature. We talk about live coals. We search not for the flames, but for that blood-red heart of the fire. Each morning on the boat, our first job is to check the stove and comment, "Oh, it's got a nice strong heart," or, "Oh, the heart's a bit weak." And a faltering heart is brought back to life by literally blowing life into it. And with every breath, that red glow pulses. In winter, even though we have central heating as a backup, the stoves are the heart of the boat. And on a frosty morning, the faint trail of blue smoke winding up into the sky from the chimney is a truly welcoming sight. At night, the eyes are continually drawn to that cherry red glow. And in fact, recent research is showing that sitting by an open or a campfire can have important physiological as well as psychological effects upon us. It's been shown that serotonin is released and there's a decrease in arterial blood pressure, inducing a sense of relaxation and well-being. So it's not surprising that when the seasonal wash of darkness gathers, we are almost instinctively drawn like moths to the fire. It's almost as if we are reminded of our more essential pasts, painted by that crackling flicker of firelight, the trance of flame dance on the ceiling, the rush of sparks, fire flying up to the stars. And even though Most of us probably have been brought up in the time of gas and electric heaters. There seems to be something that gnaws in the back of our heads to a much earlier past that was filled with spark showers and wood smoke. And that draws us when we see a fire. It reminds us of a deeper, earlier us. And this reminds me of something that I wrote perhaps about 9 or 10 years ago, following the village fireworks display. And the display is very much a community event, but because Penny is so terrified of fireworks, we could never really attend it. But we did participate by contributing with the rest of the village our clippings and cuttings to that huge bonfire. In fact, one year a tractor and trailer went from house to house picking up brushwood and branches and anything burnable. And for me, it was always the bonfire that was the main attraction and centerpiece of the night. And I called it After the Fireworks. After the fireworks, the rains came. Long silvered spears that pierced the darkness, silently slicing the once electric, tumultuous air. Slantwise and lazy, it fell upon the ground and the cardboard cones that had exploded in fountains of colour and light, with 100 gasps of spellbound breath. The leaves, slippery and wet, drifted upon the same wind that carried the fire into heaven. The wire as sparklers, as thin as dowsing rods and just as magical, pin sharp and needle hot, lay unseen upon the mud and grass where beetles forage. And the rains came for them too. The bonfire, built by men with serious faces and the light hearts of their youth, flamed with the roaring passion of a warrior in the wintering dark. Earlier, a ring of silhouettes had gathered around it to stare into its strange dance, its tattoo beating upon the more primal hearts. Fire attracts all. But its power seems to be the lightest upon the children. Excited, they run and shout to each other above the roar, but it's the elderly who seem to feel its power the greatest. The ruddy flicker deepening the lines of aged faces, contours of grief and laughter and unspent anxieties. They stand, silently staring into the deep furnace. Lost to the cold and the ticking of eternity, their eyes once more ageless as they yield to a magic that once stirred their souls. Stand here and watch those who are entering maturity and see how they will suddenly break away from the jostling throng as if something has suddenly caught their eye. Their eyes drawn to the alchemy of flame dancing under the bowl of night. And for a short while, they are stilled, silent, feeling the beat of the heat upon their faces. Watch their eyes, the way they stand, poised on adulthood. They see how this light discloses the deeper, truer, wilder beauty of the little group of girls alongside. They are learning to listen to this strange song of fire that is sirening their souls. And for a while, they stand mute and enchanted. And then the noise of childhood pulls them back. But next year, They'll be here. Standing, perhaps a little longer. Looking a little deeper. Losing themselves a little further in the great hymn of smoke and spark and flame. Forevermore, each fire they encounter in hearth or garden, they'll seek out that ancient song that called to them in their youth. And the older they get, the stronger it will be. But the rains came, even for this, hissing and soughing as the wood and the hedgerows once more come alive. And now the embers glow and wink like dragon's eyes, and the ash lies thick and black upon the grass. And it will remain there for many months to come, this circle of night where once the darkness blazed with light, and we stood together to catch once more the songs of fire. And then the rain came, the glorious festival of water and light, and with it the breathing silence of the land, once more embracing the night. This is the Narrowboat Erica, signing off for the night and wishing you a very safe, warm and peaceful night. Good night. Temperature outside 10.8 degrees. Inside 25 degrees. Humidity 73%. Dew point 7 degrees. Wind direction west southwest. Wind strength 10 miles per hour. Barometric pressure 1018 rising. Cloud cover 91%. Cloud ceiling 1900 feet. Precipitation 0.25 millimeters. Moon phase 6.4%, waxing crescent. Day length 9 hours 17 minutes. Sunset 16:28. Sky casting 7:12.